الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواج أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. قل هذه سبيلي أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة. This is, you know, the chapter of Dawah, chapter Yusuf. And I call it the chapter of Dawah. Why? Because Dawah really is done through the character. You know, enough talk, enough, you know, if you can talk to the talk, then walk the walk. But that verse, which is really the slogan of, should be the slogan of every person who wishes to give Dawah to Islam. Say, O Muhammad, this is my way of giving Dawah. أدعو إلى الله. على بصيرة. على بصيرة. Having clear insight. Crystal clear insight regarding what I'm calling you to. Insight means here that I believe it. I'm not calling you to something I doubt. I believe it. I love it. And I'm very good in conveying it to you. Ana, the Prophet said, Ana, I, wa man ittaba'ani. And anyone who wishes to follow my footsteps in giving da'wah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we live in the West, in America. And America is a very unique community because originally the foundation was Christian and then some Judaism was there. And then now we have all these other groups, religious groups, Hindus and all these others. But still, the predominant, wave is Christianity and atheism. I think there is a battle between them there. Who's going to top and who's not going to top, that's irrelevant to me. But in my opinion, one day, atheism will pass or supersede Christianity, unfortunately, because of the al-manahij, because of the school curriculum. The school curriculum is a good source of atheism in the United States of America. Now, but until this happens, we're dealing with predominant Christian community. Maybe also if you're going to find some Christian, some atheists who used to be Christians. And the reason why they are atheists, because Christianity did not meet their expectation spiritually, and they were looking for something else, and they couldn't find it. So they decided to become mulhideen, yani, atheists. Yani. The point I'm trying to make here, we have a scenario that happened during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet at one time, he wanted to send someone to Yemen, which used to be a predominant Christian / Jews also. They used to live there, huh? Some of them, yeah. إنك تأتي, the Prophet decided to send Mu'ad ibn Jabal. And he said to him, إنك تأتي قوما أهل كتاب. The place where you're going to is Christian and Jews. So let be the first thing that you call them to is Tawheed. Is Tawheed. أن يوحد الله. There is a wording, by the way. Of course, the common and famous hadith, wording of this hadith is لِيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. طيب. Brothers and sisters in Islam, and this is where the significance of the class I'm inshallah looking forward to teaching which is the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Christian and Jews, they believe in a God. You need to understand that. If you go and talk to them about a God, they believe in a God. But what is the issue? The concept is distorted. The concept of the God is distorted. Who is God? Like some Muslim sects. You know, we have some Muslim sects who believe God is, Allah is everywhere. Allah can be part of his creation, like the Christian theology. I mean, we have some Muslims who propagate stuff like that, which is not founded. So the only way for you to correct and rectify the concept of Allah, the concept of the God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the minds of Christians, in the minds of Jews, is mastering and perfecting the names and the attributes of Allah. And then you think that I'm going to be explaining names and attributes. No, I'm actually going to spend almost half of the curriculum on how to understand yourself, the names and the attributes of Allah. How can you yourself explain the names? And I'm going to teach you how to understand the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters in Islam. The curriculum is going to be very simple, and to cover that atheist side, you know, when people explain Tawheed, you know, the people who follow the Quran and Sunnah, not the people who want to follow their own heretical theories, because the people who, you know, the grave worshippers, they want to see Tawheed like the Arab, like the pagan Arabs, which is what Tawheed is only rububiyyah, that you believe Allah created me, that's it. But the dua, give it to someone else. You can give the attributes of Allah also to your sheikh tariqah, to your engraved person, so you can call that. When you explain Tawheed, there are three ways to go about it. Three ways. Number one, the famous approach, the three, Tawheed, Al-Rububiyya, Al-Uluhiyya, Al-Asma' wa-Sifat. So this is طيب. The second, which the one I adopt in my writing, is Al-Ilmi, Al-Amali, that you combine the Lordship with the names and the attributes, and you call this Tawheed al-Recognition, the knowledge of Allah. Who is Allah? And then Al-Uluhiyya is one time. In this class, I'm going to adopt this because I want to cover the area of the atheist, where you begin with proving that Allah exists. Two, he is the Lord. Three, no one is like him, the names and the attributes, and then you worship him. We're not going to go so much into the worship here because we want them to accept this first. We want them to accept Allah exists. And that would apply only to an atheist, because a Christian and Jew knows that Allah exists. Now, a Christian and Jew, come, let's talk about the Lordship of Allah. Let's talk about the names and the attributes of Allah. So this is the curriculum in brief, inshallah. I'm very much looking forward, I guess, to this. I have a book called Know Your Lord. That's where I'm going to be teaching the curriculum from, inshallah. Allahu Akbar.